Institut Français promotes cultural dialogues between France and its international partners in very different fields. From music to dance, from dance to theater and cinema, and also in the field of public debate and social sciences. And in each field, we try to meet new interlocutors, develop new partnerships, and I think that there are different ways to begin a dialogue. There are wrong ones and right ones. I'm not a sociologist. I study philosophy, and I remember that in a seminar on possible worlds, a famous philosopher, French philosopher named Jacques Bouvresse, said he once asked, "Why is? Do you know why the expression 'if I were you' is so annoying? It's so annoying because when you say 'if I were you,' you mean if I had your problems and my solutions, and that's not a way to begin a dialogue. So I think that these days, this session, and this all these initiatives, this initiative makes a different bet. We have problem. We both have problems regarding urban democracy, discrimination, urban equality and inequality. And we have to, maybe the best we can do is to compare our problems and share our solutions, and if not solutions, our leads to build better cities as in France and United States. So it's a very original experiment try to discuss not only between American and French researchers, but also between researchers and social workers, activists, etc. That's the concept of Cité, and I hope and we at the Institut Français are really committed to continue this experiment of next year in Detroit, for example. So I'd like to say thank you to all our partners in this operation. Thank you. Thanks a lot to University of Chicago to host us today. And I wish you good debates and a good day of dialogue. Thank you. And now I give the speech to Denis Quesnel from French Consulate.
Thank you, Mathieu. Good morning, everyone. So these 2 days of discussions on key issues of urban life is the first phase of a long-term project. Our goal is to generate a dialogue with key actors and representatives currently working on these issues from both sides of the Atlantic. Academics and researchers, of course, but also policymakers, community organizers and activists, art leaders and artists. This dialogue should bring to light the current situation in each country with a focus in the fight against discrimination, the tense relationship between law enforcement and citizens, and the role and action of youth, art leaders and artists in the renewal of neighborhoods. This exchange should also highlight the best urban practices in order to shape future public policies. The ultimate objective, we hope, is to create a French-American Center for Urban Practices that will contribute to the renewal of urban cities with strong involvement of its citizens reclaiming their neighborhood, especially young people. This transatlantic exchange is one of a series of our projects linked to the south side of Chicago. In partnership with independent French curator Guillaume Desanges and the Rebuild Foundation of artist Siesta Gates, we have created this summer a residency program for French artists in the south side called Method Room. After French architect Xavier Vronat, the Method Room is currently hosting the collective Le Peuple qui Manque that will lead a work on Afrofuturism. Another residency program will also be created next year at the Hyde Park Art Center in partnership with Centre of Photography in the Nord-Pas-de-Calais region of France, leading up to collective exhibits with French and Chicago artists. We also hope to work next year with the Black Cinema House to screen a series on African Francophone cinema. Finally, the Centre Pompidou, which is the largest French museum of modern art in France, envisions of opening a temporary installation in the south side. This installation would present exhibits in architecture, design, visual, and performing arts curated by the Centre Pompidou and local Chicagoan museums. So I am happy now to give the floor to Michael Dawson, who is a professor in the Department of Political Science and the director of the Center for the Study of Race, Politics, and Culture, who will introduce our keynote speaker.
On behalf of the Center for the Study of Race, Politics, and Culture, and our colleagues at the university and from France, I also would like to welcome you to Cité, Race and Youth in the 21st Century Metropolis. Everyone in this room understands the importance of cities, including within the United States. Cities are the cultural, scientific, and social incubator that provided the motive for progress throughout the world. Unfortunately, unlike in many other parts of the world, in the United States, cities and their residents are often viewed with suspicion and sometimes hostility by other citizens. And yet, once again, our cities are both our hope for the future and a concern in the present as they face increasing tensions, including declining resources, the need for economic revitalization, and a more just distribution of economic, political, and social benefits across all of their residents. Within the United States, we have to address the implication for moving to a majority-minority America, which has already occurred in a few states and several urban areas. The terrain is shifting in complex ways that includes not only increasing diversity from immigration, but inter and intra-group conflicts, racial tensions, intergenerational conflicts, and the fact that growing numeric strength for a racial minority has not in a straightforward manner translated to economic, political, and social strength. While there are new forms of racial discrimination, many scholars and political observers argue that white supremacy is still a system of racial hierarchy that, while changed in an important way, still within the United States affects one's economic and social chances. We see racial hierarchies interact with those of class and gender in the continuing challenges that, among others, gentrification presents to equity in a number of domains, including housing, political power, and processes of marginalization. The center is excited to be part of the organizing effort for putting together these conferences. Urban affairs is a longstanding focus of the research and teaching at the center. Part of our 20th anniversary year is focused on the contributions that the studies of race and ethnicity globally can continue to make to intellectual inquiry and making a better world for all of us. We'd like to deeply extend our thanks to everyone that's put this together, and in particular our colleagues from the French Academy, government, and the activists who fight various forms of discrimination in their urban environments, and we will learn much from you today. It's with extreme pleasure that I introduce our keynote speaker, who has been inspiring all of us with her rigorous and insightful scholarship. Mary Pattillo is Professor of Sociology and African American Studies, faculty affiliate at the Institute for Policy Research at Northwestern University. She received her PhD from the University of Chicago. Pattillo's areas of interest include race and ethnicity, the Black middle class, policy, inequality, urban sociology, and qualitative methods. Professor Pattillo uses the city of Chicago as her laboratory and strives to be an expert, and I wouldn't say strive, she is an expert in Chicago history, politics, and social life. In her first book, Black Picket Fences, Pattillo investigated the economic, spatial, and cultural forces that affect child rearing and youth socialization in a black middle class neighborhood on Chicago's South Side. Just as a side, whenever I teach the book, which is every year, the students still are trying to guess what neighborhood that is. They could just call you. Her second book, Black on the Block, focused on gentrification and public housing transformation in North Kenwood, Oakland, and Chicago's South Side. The book developed the concept of middle men and middle women, the roles that black professionals play in working alternatively to mediate or exacerbate racial and class inequality. It won the Robert Parks Book Award and a proclamation from the City of Chicago. Current research projects include a study of how parents negotiate school choice, the impact of housing on families and children, and the prevalence and impact of monetary sanctions in the Illinois criminal justice system. Professor Pattillo also has a growing interest in race in Latin America. Pattillo has also written numerous articles in addition to her award-winning books, and a founding board member and active participant in Urban Prep Charter Academy, the first all-boys public charter high school in Chicago. I can't think of a better keynote speaker for our discussion today. Please join me in welcoming Professor Mary Pattillo, who will speak on the future of Black Metropolis.
Thank you very much, Michael, for that wonderful introduction. It's great to be back at the University of Chicago. I make it sound like I'm all that far away. I live right up the street, but it's good to be on campus, actually, and speaking and in this beautiful venue for this absolutely wonderful event and to see so many wonderful, friendly faces. Hi, Charles. I won't start doing that unless I miss someone, but thanks, everyone, for coming early in the morning as well. So I'll be speaking about my new foreword to the classic book, Black Metropolis, which literally I just got in the mail yesterday. It's now published. This is the new cover. My editor, David Morrow, is here from the University of Chicago Press. So I'm very excited to be speaking here on the South Side about this new edition of Black Metropolis. Blackness stretches over the land. Blackness, the black of it. The rust red of it, the milk and cream of it, the tan and yellow tan of it, the deep brown, middle brown, high brown of it, the olive and ochre of it, blackness marches on. Gwendolyn Brooks, poet laureate of Chicago, wrote the poem Primer for Blacks in 1980, and it still applies today. Stand at the corner of 63rd and Racine, 79th and Yates, Pulaski and Roosevelt Road, 119th and Halstead, or Lake and Laramie in Chicago, and you'll see where, quote, blackness stretches over the land. Go to the Chicago suburbs of Dalton or Harvey or Maywood, and you'll see where blackness marches on. The city of Chicago is home to the second largest black population in the United States behind New York City. Black Chicago continues to nurture artistic creativity, economic innovation, and political imagination. Black Metropolis persists in the 21st century. Yet at the same time, today, less than half of African Americans across the country live in predominantly black neighborhoods. More black people are living in the suburbs, and while there are predominantly black suburbs, most of those suburbs are racially integrated. Finally, due to sheer changes in demography in the country, blacks are more likely now to live with non-blacks and non-whites, in other words, more likely to live with Latinos and Asians than they did in the 1940s when Black Metropolis was published. In other words, African Americans are less likely to live in the kinds of neighborhoods that St. Clair Drake and Horace Caton studied in their landmark book, Black Metropolis. So in some respects, Black Metropolis is dead in the 21st century. So these are two perspectives. Black Metropolis persists, Black Metropolis is dead. I'm in an African American studies department. I'm not gonna land on the side of Black Metropolis is dead. So to preview my comments, I will talk about ways in which Black Metropolis persists. My argument is that Chicago remains an iconic and particularly extreme form a black residential settlement, where black metropolis definitely lives on. However, we must also look to the suburbs and to the south to find today's thriving black metropolises. Moreover, the cinch of the black belt has slowly but steadily loosened. The diffusion of the black belt has clear class contours, as it did in the 1940s, and has resulted in many black areas that are not uniformly defined by their poverty. These processes have the simultaneous effect of decreasing the hold of black metropolis on the imaginations and possibilities of some black folks, increasing the commitment to making it a place of greater, although not total, voluntariness for others, and maintaining the black belt and black metropolis as important analytical categories that structure the experiences and outcomes of a large number of African Americans in Chicago and in cities across the country. So what I'd like to do today is talk briefly about the book Black Metropolis and present some of the powerful analytical frameworks that Drake and Caton offered for thinking about black residential patterns and community life. Then I'll give a demographic portrait of majority black spaces in Chicago and across the country today. Then I'll use one of Drake and Caton's analytical tools they call the axes of life and focus on the importance of studying life in black metropolis. And then finally, I'll conclude. So Drake and Caton's third contribution to the study of black metropolis is this differentiation between the black ghetto or the black belt on one side and black metropolis or Bronzeville on the other. I offer four very important analytical contributions. I'll be focusing on the final two and won't be talking much about the two that are in gray at the top. So the black ghetto or the black belt and black metropolis or Bronzeville or the South Side, these terms are not interchangeable. The black ghetto is the physical space into which blacks are segregated. It's a place of subordination. The black ghetto is imposed and enforced by whites for discriminatory, economic, and status reasons. Black metropolis, on the other hand, is what blacks create out of the black ghetto. It's a space of sociality, of commerce, of leisure, of morality, debate, and meaning. This nomenclature is a subtle but crucial intervention. Outsiders have a hard time seeing Bronzeville. All they see is the black ghetto. Drake and Caton study both. Part two of the book, A Black Metropolis, is about the black ghetto. It maps, counts, graphs, and narrates how racism fixes the status of blacks and subordinates blacks into, quote, servant jobs and neighborhoods rife with tuberculosis and poverty. Part three of the book, and Black Metropolis is a thick book. Where's Andrew? Andrew has a copy there. That's how thick it is. It's a thick book, and I added a good 30 pages, but obviously most of those pages are Drake and Caton. So part three of the book is about black metropolis, characterized by a, quote, tenacious clinging to life, a, quote, struggle for liberty, a, quote, quest for happiness. It's where black folks read from five weekly newspapers, worship at 475 churches, buy from 2,464 businesses, and play the numbers, which is the what preceded the lottery, at nearly 500 policy stations. Black metropolis is a place of institutional diversity, hard living, cultural richness, and social vitality built upon the sobering demographic and political realities of the black ghetto. This indivisibility of the black ghetto and black metropolis is apparent in Drake and Caton's use of their idea of a city within a city. They write, quote, black metropolis is an object of pride to Negroes of all social strata. It is their city within a city. It is something of our own. It is concrete evidence of one type of freedom, freedom to erect a community in their own image. Yet they remain ambivalent about residential segregation. They see a gain in political strength and group solidarity, but they resent being compelled to live in a black belt. So in other words, living together was not the issue for blacks in the 1940s. Having no choice about it was. I would argue that that same tension exists today, both in black communities and in the scholarship about them. Can black metropolis escape, overcome, or defeat the forced nature of the black ghetto? Can the two be disentangled? Can black metropolis thrive as a creative, generative, and healthy space, given that it originates from the racist determination that black people be denied access to those very same things? So what and where is the black metropolis today? Since black metropolis is geographically bound up with the black belt, we need to begin by looking at the contemporary presence of majority black spaces in Chicago and beyond. And we can start by looking at spaces that are over 50% black, or as this figure shows, over 90% black. You can't see the key way up there at the top, and I can't point this because that's too far away, but the grayer areas are areas that are over 50% black, and the darker, almost, they're darker gray really, but they look black there, are the areas that are over 95% black. So these figures show neighborhoods in Chicago and Cook County, the city here in 1940, and Cook County that hadn't yet been mapped with the census tract data. So we see Cook County in 1940, 1970, 1990, and 2010. These illustrate that both the South and the West Side black belts have expanded greatly in size from roughly 8 square miles in the 1940s when Drake and Caton studied black metropolis to, I don't know how many square miles that is today, but quite a large swath of the South Side reaching into the South Suburbs and the West Side. While there are fewer nearly all black neighborhoods in the suburbs, the growth in the number of areas to the south and west of the city that are over 50% black is evident. So we see, you can't really see the city line much anymore, but those areas to the far south and some of the near west areas are areas that are over 50% black in the suburbs. Chicago is not alone in the shift of its black population to the suburbs. In the 100 largest metro areas in the country, more than half of all African Americans live in the suburbs rather than in the cities. Looking outside of Chicagoland, to the rest of the country, reveals dozens of sizable and substantial black communities across the country. So what you see here is a list of the 13 metropolitan areas that all have 10 or more neighborhoods that are over 95% black. So these neighborhoods are really census tracts. They consist of roughly 4,000 residents each in each census tract. So these black belts house at least 40,000 people in these various cities. The high level of black concentration is a very strict definition of the black belt. So here again, I'm talking about black neighborhoods that are over 95% black. So these are nearly all black neighborhoods. Yet still, Chicago has 171 such neighborhoods, far more than any other city in the country. And indeed, I see you all mentioned you're next going to Detroit. We are followed closely by the city of Detroit. So that's a fitting next stop for the conversation that you all are having. So this is partially because of the sheer size of Chicago, both its geographic size and its population size. But it also conveys the magnitude, the coverage, and the distinctiveness of Chicago's black belt. Less stringent definitions of black belts will yield more such neighborhoods across the country. So for example, if we include places that are over 80% black, we get a much larger list of cities that have black belts with a number of neighborhoods that are over 80% black. While most of these black belts are in cities, they appear in suburbs too. Black suburbanization is one manifestation of the growth of the black middle and upper classes. The heterogeneity of the contemporary black belt cannot be understated. For example, Drake and Caton would be surprised to know a place like View Park Windsor Hills in Los Angeles, where over 80% of the 11,000 residents are black, and where the annual median family income is over $110,000. This table also illustrates that looking beyond Chicago requires us to retrain our sights on the US South. 6 of the 13 metro areas listed here are in the South. So you see Memphis and Atlanta and Birmingham and Jackson and New Orleans. And 3 are in border regions, Baltimore, Washington, and St. Louis. Perhaps most tellingly, by 2012, the Atlanta metropolitan area had overtaken Chicagoland as home to the second largest black population after New York. So New York City is first and New York metro area is first for the total number of black residents. Atlanta metro area is second and Chicago metro area is third, but Chicago City is second because, of course, Atlanta is such a sprawling metro area. Most of Atlanta's blacks live in the suburbs, not in the city. So Atlanta has overtaken Chicago. Atlanta metro area has overtaken Chicago as housing the second largest black population. While these data establish that there are still miles and miles of black spaces in cities, in suburbs, and in every region of the country, there is also significant heterogeneity within and between black neighborhoods. And it's also true that over time, fewer and fewer African Americans live in such places. The level of racial segregation between blacks and whites in neighborhoods has declined steadily since 1970. This means that African Americans are less likely to live in majority black neighborhoods than they did during Drake and Caton's time. I promise you, I won't give you all numbers in this talk. I'm an ethnographer, after all. So my ethnography friends don't disown me. I have a little demography, and then we'll get to the more qualitative stuff. But I think it's important to contextualize Chicago and also talk about the contemporary black belts around the country. So what these figures that I'm about to show illustrate is that the proportion of blacks who live in majority black neighborhoods in Chicago, in the Chicago metropolitan area, and in all metropolitan areas across the country over this period of time from 1940, 1970, 1990 to 2010 has declined. So this figure 3 here shows the proportion of African Americans who live in neighborhoods that are over 50% black. So they're majority black neighborhoods, and this is the proportion of blacks who live in such neighborhoods in the city of Chicago, in the Chicago metro area, and in all metro areas across the country. The pattern is one of declining proportions at all 3 levels of geography and on both measures, especially in the most recent period. The city of Chicago remains extremely racially segregated. The declines are more dramatic, however, in the Chicago metropolitan area, where you see 68% of African Americans live in majority black neighborhoods. In the city, 84% of all blacks live in majority black neighborhoods. In the metro area, 68% live in all black neighborhoods. And if you look at all metro areas across the country, that's where you see that actually the minority of black people in the country live in majority black neighborhoods. So 42% of blacks live in majority black neighborhoods across the country. This is what raises the question of, are we at the end of black metropolis? Obviously in Chicago we're not, but many African Americans are not experiencing the residential reality of a majority black neighborhood. So this is my gesture to the fact that we are at a comparative conference. My research is on Chicago, but we can compare Chicago, which now you can barely see in that figure to the left, but it's the same figure I just had up, with 2 statistics from immigrant residential patterns in Paris. So in Paris, less than 20% of all immigrants live in neighborhoods that are over 50% immigrants. So whereas in the city of Chicago, 68% of all African Americans live in majority, 84% of all African Americans live in majority black neighborhoods, less than 20% of immigrants in Paris live in majority immigrant neighborhoods. I know the comparison is not exact, and we will be debating, I'm sure, for the rest of the day, this discussion about black Chicago versus immigrant Paris, which is quite different, but you see that as a very different reality from the black racial residential segregation here and the residential patterns of immigrants in Paris. Also, 70% of all immigrants in Paris live in neighborhoods where they constitute less than 30% of the population. So the modal residential pattern for immigrants in Paris is integration. The modal residential pattern for blacks in Chicago is living in predominantly black neighborhoods, while the modal residential pattern for African Americans is living in neighborhoods that aren't majority black across the country. And then finally, this is a figure that shows living in nearly all black neighborhoods, which I mentioned, this is the kind of neighborhood that Drake and Caton studied in the 1940s, neighborhoods that are over 95% black. And you see that still in the city of Chicago, 51% of African Americans live in neighborhoods that are nearly all black. 29% in the metro area live in neighborhoods that are nearly all black. And 6% of blacks across the country live in such neighborhoods. So again, it's the very, very small minority of African Americans across the country who live in nearly all black neighborhoods, although it is the experience of the slight majority of blacks in Chicago to live in such neighborhoods. So we see declining patterns in each of these measures. So from 1990 to 2010, each of these numbers has gone down precipitously. To be sure, this is not the end of racial segregation in America. Black-white residential segregation remains high and even extreme in many cities like Chicago. Nevertheless, these slow declines illustrate a weakening of the mechanisms that enforced the black ghetto of the 1940s. Given these trends, we might ask, to what extent is the black belt today imposed rather than chosen, enforced or voluntary? So that's a long literature, and there are many debates in that literature, and I don't have time to review all of that literature today, but I think it's fair to say that while the ways in which the black belt is enforced are not as explicit today as they were in the 1940s, there are definitely still such mechanisms of enforcement. At the same time, and within those practices of enforcement, blacks express historically shaped preferences for living around other blacks and make moves that express those preferences. Moreover, what if we think, if we also think about black metropolis as not requiring residence in a black residential space, but rather a connection to that space in some way? Recall that for Drake and Caton, the black belt and black metropolis are not one and the same. So these are all visions or illustrations of the black belt, but the black metropolis might be also a community of the mind as opposed to just geographic residential location. Our Chicago poet Gwendolyn Brooks continues her verse with the following. The word black has geographic power, pulls everybody in. Blacks here, blacks there, blacks wherever they may be. So black metropolis continues to thrive within the persisting but much expanded geographic container of the black belt. But it's also not just home to those who live there, but it's also a reference and returning point for the many who have moved out. What is it that keeps and draws black folks to black metropolis? How are black people performing the axes of life in Chicago's black metropolis today? So one of the important contributions of black metropolis is their discussion of the axes of life, five axes of life: staying alive, having fun, serving God, getting ahead, and advancing the race. This is what black folks do in black metropolis. Indeed, this is what folks do. This is what humans do. And this is what I love about black metropolis, is that it highlights the humanity of folks who otherwise are characterized only as living in a black ghetto. So I'm going to be focusing on having fun. This is a Facebook announcement of the 2014 family reunion of the Stateway Gardens public housing complex on the city's south side. They come together annually to share the good and bad memories of life in the projects, to celebrate their lasting bonds of friendship and kinship, and to stake their place in Chicago despite efforts to remove them. The last high-rise in State Way Gardens was demolished in 2007. Most of the high-rise public housing in the city has gone the way of State Way Gardens, demolished in order to make way for new developments that mix low, middle, and high-income families all together, along with new upscale amenities and businesses. Across the U.S., nearly 250,000 people have been displaced by public housing demolitions, and over 80% of them have been African American. Yet while the high-rises are gone, the former residents pull back together, reconstitute their bonds, relive their memories, and perform important acts of placemaking through reunions and other forms of virtual and in-person collective gathering. As the African American poet Maya Angelou wrote, quote, "You may trod me in the very dirt, but still, like dust, I'll rise." These reunions bring people together in a meaningful gathering place. The most salient places for the residents were the buildings. All of those buildings are gone. So unlike a high school reunion where you go back to your old gym and put up all the pictures of what you looked like when you were young, public housing residents don't have the public housing buildings to go back to. Moreover, the layout of the space is often radically different from how it used to be. The city planners have also discarded the original names of the public housing complex. The Ida B. Wells Homes, named for the African-American anti-lynching crusader and journalist, has now become Oakwood Shores. The Jane Addams Homes, named for the immigrant settlement house movement leader, has been renamed Roosevelt Square. The Henry Horner Homes, named for Illinois' first Jewish governor, has become West Haven Park, and on and on and on. And still in other locations, there's just nothing, still vacant land where the public housing projects had once stood. Nonetheless, Chicago city leaders have not yet figured out how to make a place on the map completely disappear. And so former public housing residents have some rough coordinates at which to gather. In 2003, former residents of Cabrini Green began organizing old school Mondays at a public park in the middle of the mostly demolished development. A documentary of old school Mondays and all of the Cabrini Green residents was recently released by the filmmaker Ronit Bezalel. It's touring around a number of film festivals, so I encourage you to check it out. This is a clip from one of the clips from the documentary. It shows hundreds of people dancing in the park, hugging and barbecuing, exchanging phone numbers and watching children play. People are elated to be back on familiar ground. "It's about home," says one woman and a trio of women being interviewed for the film. Another chimes in, "Cabrini's always gonna be home." The first jumps back in, "even though it's not physically here," and the second finishes her sentence with, "but as long as we're around each other, we're feeling it still." In other parts of the city, the reunions live on. The old school Mondays are no longer, but these reunions happen still in other parts of the city. Residents of the former Henry Horner Homes gathered at nearby Union Park in the summer of 2014. You see on their Facebook page, quote, "I had a great time at the Henry Horner picnic." Another wrote, "Glad we were able to get together like this. HH for life." The State Way Gardens reunion was also in August, and it took place in Dunbar Park. So in parks across the city, it's not that the residents have moved out of the Black Belt altogether, but they're coming back to the neighborhoods where they had once lived. In addition to bringing people back together, reunions are also about memories, this community of the mind that I mentioned. One Facebook post pays tribute to a recently deceased drama teacher from the public school that many State Way Gardens young people had attended. She writes, quote, "I was one of his favorites when I was a kid, and he pushed me to strive to be the best, cracking that whip on me to deliver weeks of memorable performances of Dorothy and the Wizard of Oz. I wonder if he knew what his contributions and dedications meant to us all." At the height of their occupancy in the 1970s, Chicago's family public housing was officially home to over 137,000 people, most of them African American, And that's probably an underestimate, because with people who were not officially on the lease and squatters in vacant units and so on, some estimates put that number at least 40% higher than the 137,000 I just quoted. In 2012, the population in family public housing in Chicago was just over 23,000. And we see this illustrated in the changing demography of Chicago's Black Belt. So again, you can't really see, and this pointer isn't really reaching. Okay, so this is where in 1990, the South Side public housing projects would have been and the West Side public housing projects. And you see in those areas, they've tipped now from being 95% Black to over 50% Black on both the South and West Sides. And again, you see the Black Belt expanding in the southern suburbs. I should note, it's not that the public housing residents were moving to the suburbs. Most of the data has shown that they've moved mostly within the city, so it's not that pattern, it's not that causal relationship there. But definitely you see the decreasing Black population in the neighborhoods where public housing had once stood. Despite this drastic population loss, and even though demolishing the projects was deeply painful for many residents, spaces of Black communal life have been reconstituted through in-person reunions in the old neighborhoods, online spaces of celebrations, and communities of memory. In other words, the disappearing of Black public housing residents in Chicago was unsuccessful. Witness how the children of former public housing residents proclaim their public housing lineage. You can't see what she writes on the bottom here, but she writes, quote, "Me and my pops at the Robert Taylor reunion. He grew up in building 4101. Had to capture that." But it's in the pithiest of slogans that insist on making and claiming place in the city. "Fuck you, I'm from Robert Taylor Homes," announces this meme on one person's Facebook page, and someone comments on it, "Better know it." So no matter the disregard, the disparagement, the disdain, and the demolition, Black Metropolis still rises in celebration and pleasure, practicing one of the axes of life, of having fun and with doing so with righteous indignation. Black Metropolis, the book, established Chicago's Black community as the focal point for scholarship and inquiry for years to come. It is the original Black Metropolis. It's like the OG of Black metropolises. But it's not the only Black Metropolis. Instead, it stands as a departure point for research on new urban formations and geographies. Black Metropolis persists as collections of predominantly Black and class-diverse neighborhoods that are a result of new forms of enforcement of racial segregation and new freedoms to be able to choose places that have sustaining families and social networks and uplifting institutions and that satisfy desires to participate in one of Drake and Caton's other axes of life, advancing the race. Black Metropolis goes much beyond the hemmed-in community that Drake and Caton studied. It reaches into the suburbs and is deeply rooted in the South. And it also goes beyond the geography of all Black neighborhoods. As Omar McRoberts' work shows, on Sundays, Black families return to Black Metropolis for church. As Celeste Watkins Hayes' research shows, Black professionals disproportionately work as teachers and social workers and police officers and welfare bureaucrats, keeping them closely tied to Black Metropolis, even if they don't live there. And Karen Lacey's research shows, even within white neighborhoods, when Blacks live in white neighborhoods, Blacks create improvised Black metropolises in their own homes through their artwork and by joining exclusively Black social groups or by building organizations especially for Black children and Black families. These scholars and the short vignette I presented today depict the life in Black Metropolis. Drake and Caton's framework offers a broad corrective to the imbalanced social science research on Black communities, which often portrays urban Black residents and their neighborhoods as bounded, as plagued by violence, as victims and perpetrators, as unproductive, and as isolated from one another and from the city writ large, if not also pathological and dangerous and depressing. The fact that Black Metropolis is characterized by the axes of life counters that neighborhood, that narrative, by focusing on the agency, the intent, and even the spontaneity of urban Black residents in creating places that are sustaining, affirming, and pleasurable. Focusing on Black life does not aim to curtail the research on the racism that continues to undermine the ability of Black folks to live peacefully and productively in the city. Instead, the goal of highlighting life is to offer a reminder that all Black spaces are not derelict, overgrown, unruly, and destructive spaces. They are not inherently inferior spaces for which the only remedy is demolition or class and race integration. To the contrary, if life in Black Metropolis is as fun, as witty, as soulful, as smart, as biting, as well-dressed, as we saw in the first picture, and as rejuvenating as public housing reunions and the many other examples that all of us in this room could give, imagine what it could be in a more just and equitable city. Thank you.
Thank you very much for those words. I'm sort of the unofficial timekeeper, so we're a bit late, but we have time for two or three questions, and I pointed over there earlier for the questions, and in fact, it's right here. So if two or three of you would like to get up and then form the line around here, we have time for two or three questions before we break.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So I've done research and I've worked in the housing realm, and I was very troubled because a lot of the new social science research that's being done has conclusions that essentially say extracting Black populations and then placing them into majority white or, you know, dominant populations has better outcomes for things like education and final income. And I'm troubled by it because I feel like it doesn't take into account a lot of the cultural factors that you're talking about and the enrichment that comes out of, you know, living in a Black-centered space. So how does one who's in that kind of a policy field take into account that very dry data and try to incorporate a richer idea of what it means and what value comes out of being in a Black metropolis?
Mm-hmm. Thank you for the question. So as someone who does work on housing and on policy, you well know that the key debate in the housing world is place-based strategies versus mobility strategies. Place-based strategies are invest in communities as they are. Mobility strategies are the places are so bad right now, we have to get people out as quickly as possible. And so these come through housing choice vouchers, opportunity moves, those kinds of things. So this is a real debate in the literature. You know, many people, I think, are now starting to write, it's an unfortunate debate. We need not, I think, be at loggerheads about this issue, partially because I think the important thing is that people should be able to move if they want to. And insofar as building affordable housing in predominantly white neighborhoods or suburbia allows people to move if they want to, or giving housing choice vouchers and giving people counseling to move where they want to, I think all of that's a good thing. But my, I think, point is we all begin with the same sentence, that There are obviously many negative ramifications of living in a concentrated poverty area, and even we find there are negative ramifications of residential racial segregation. And then the question becomes, well, what are the mechanisms? And from what I can tell, definitely in the research on school segregation, racial segregation, the mechanisms are about resources. The mechanisms are about expectations. The mechanisms are about ideologies and stigma of racism. And so we can, once we agree on the first point, to me the answer is not, okay, we need to make sure white kids sit next to Black kids, but rather, and you know, Du Bois is famous for saying, I don't need integrated I'm not gonna get it right, somebody here knows it better, but integrated education or segregated education, we need good education, we don't need integrated schools, segregated schools, we need good schools. And so that's kind of where I put my efforts. And to answer your question about what social scientists might do, is what I'm trying to do in this second part of the talk that I gave here, which is part of a larger paper on black placemaking in the city. So I gave the example of public housing reunions. We have three other examples: black LGBTQ nightlife in the city. They're all about Chicago. The Jackie Robinson West Little League teams, victories, and black life online. So black Twitter feeds and other kinds of participation in black communities virtually. And I think, you know, spending more time on black life, I think apropos of the slogan of Black Lives Matter, illustrating why black lives matter, not as if we need a justification for or a rationalization for why black lives matter, but the social science, as I mentioned, is imbalanced to suggest that there's only bad things happening in black communities. And I think representing all of the life that happens in black communities is part of our countering of the idea that people must be moved out and moved out quickly, or we must deconcentrate black neighborhoods. So that would be how I respond to that. Hello.
Greetings. It's a pleasure to be here with you this morning.
Pleasure to see you.
It was a superb presentation.
Thank you.
Again, my name is Harold Lucas. I'm president and CEO of Black Metropolis Convention and Tourism Council, which is a 501c3 not-for-profit destination marketing organization for the historic Brownsville community. And from a future Brownsville perspective, it is clear from Professor Pattillo's narrative that Brownsville is the most important community probably in the country from an African-American perspective as an international tourism destination, and that the University of Chicago should truly embrace us as opposed to crushing the authentic experience as it tried to do, and which Caton and Drake really documented. You know, I can call the question all day long from 1942 when the question was asked. And the question was, will the Negro, and we were Negroes then, find and meet in his humiliation, turn his slums and his sweatshops into modern cathedrals out of which will be born a new spirit that will guide him towards freedom. We have done just that. We have saved the Supreme Life Building and a number of other landmark structures. We are ready to develop Brownsville as an international tourism destination. We have multiple sites and attractions which need to be invested in. We have a lot of disadvantaged African-American male youth who are not focused into growth industries where the jobs are going to be in the 21st century, including coding, et cetera. And we need to get about the business of making that happen. So in that regard, what do we do that we're celebrating next year? The centennial of the Great Migration, centennial to Chicago. There is a planning process. There is a geographic map, not only of the boundaries of Brownsville left by Drake and Caton, but the entire South Lakefront region of Chicago, all the way around to Gary, Indiana, is an emerging area anchored by the fight over a diet school, right? And where they want to put the presidential library, which incidentally should go to 31st in the lakefront and not to either one of our national parks, either on Washington Park, right? And I can tell you who lived in all them houses before the USC had them torn down, and how they take it on 55th Street and 61st Street, et cetera. We see y'all, all right? And I'm born 662 East 38th Place, Ida B. Wells, all power to the people, right? We're going to build this from the bottom up, y'all. Y'all need to help us.
And that's your answer to the question. What do we do? Keep on doing what you've been doing. You have been an incredible community leader to making sure all these things stay on the table. So thank you very much.
Good morning, Mary, and thank you so much for that presentation. I've got to figure out, I don't have room for a third edition of that book, but I'll have to do something. But my question relates to, what is the body of study that we can use as a community to continue, shall we say, the Black Metropolis when it is more dispersed? And the balance between, shall we put it, asset value and sense of place, and how do we strengthen our culture and environment when, as you said, more of us are teachers versus how many of us need to be equity traders and coders. Mm. If you figure that sometimes people are criticized for leaving the community to go do X and not staying to do Y, but if you stay to do Y, you generally can't make enough money to do for even your own family, let alone to a degree, let alone others. And also the issue of if a community, and this is again spoken from the background in community development lending, if the community is a black community, identified black community, it does not have the asset value to improve it as you do if it's integrated. But once it is integrated, you lose the culture, mm-hmm. you lose a lot of the cultural value. So where is the body that thinks about from a national perspective, because again, there are other places, but again, we are the most hyper-segregated. How do we balance those things to produce a healthy and continually culturally exceptional community?
Mm-hmm.
That's my question.
Yes, that's a great question, a big question, right? I'm going to go out on a limb and say something publicly that I always say at home. For those of you all who I see frequently, I'd love to hear your thoughts about this and some of my neighbors. So I live in North Kenwood, Oakland. It's the neighborhood where I wrote about in Black on the Block. It's a neighborhood that has experienced the in-movement of a number of black professionals and some slight in-movement of non-black professionals. It was a neighborhood that had been extremely poor, 40-50% poverty rates, in some census tracts, 70% poverty rates. There was public housing that was torn down, but there remains some public housing and scattered site public housing. And all of that was really hot right before Black on the Block was published in 2007. And then, of course, we had the crash in 2007, and it stalled. Not completely stalled, but generally stalled. And I will say right now, I feel like I live in black paradise. That's what I'm saying. I say at home, and I don't really say out loud. And I'd be curious about my neighbors who live in North Kenwood, Oakland. The stalling stopped the complete displacement of the low-income population who lives there still. And you go to Mandrake Park at 39th and Cottage Grove / Drexel, where I go work out in the morning, and it is black paradise. It is black folks of all shapes, size, colors, you know, working out. Kids, people, as they're doing their walking, they're walking their strollers, you know, have their kids walking with them. It's phenomenal. And it's right next door to the redone Ida B. Wells homes, which, you know, it's not that I think that the Ida B. Wells home should have been demolished. They were in very good shape, and I think we could have done a mixed-income community right there in the existing things with low-income and moderate-income folks, so that's a different story. But it is right next to Oakwood Shores, and it's black paradise. So I guess my answer is, I don't know, have what looks to be a really hot market and then stall the market altogether. But really, I think the answer is, any process, you know, investment in low-income black communities is always scary because we think gentrification is happening right behind it. And that is, a reasonable fear. And so what it means is we can't obviously create a housing crash in the moment of gentrification, but we do have public policies that can put brakes on that kind of investment. What happens is early on in the investment in low-income communities, nobody ever imagines that it's gonna be as hot as it eventually becomes. When North Kenwood, Oakland first started planning in the 80s, some people had a vision that would be super hot, but nobody imagined that you'd use up all the one-third of the whole land that was vacant at that time would eventually be built on. And then the land would be too expensive to build affordable housing on it. So without community land trusts, without rent controls, without perhaps one of the ideas right now is giving people housing choice vouchers to stay in place in gentrifying neighborhoods, as opposed to these opportunity vouchers that moves people from the neighborhood at the exact moment when it's getting better. So housing choice vouchers to stay in place in a place like North Kenwood, Oakland. These are the kinds of things that might put brakes on a process that usually steamrolls a neighborhood and doesn't stop it in this moment where folks can remain in place and new people can come in that, you know, kind of increase the tax base and that kind of thing. So I think that's kind of what I would say. Well, I have to ask the organizers if we need to move on so that the next presenters have enough time as well. Sorry. So thank you all very much. And have a great day.